Killing Demons, Study of Game, and it's one of my favorite topics. Like teaching him. Each time I teach it, it comes out differently. And as the Lord leads, God guides it. So I'm also helping to have some live demonstration, not just teach, but also demonstrate. So that'll be next. There are a few others also interested in the topic. Good. All right. So about the will of God, we want to study something very important today. But just a quick summary of what we covered in the last 3 weeks. The first...
Do you have your mic?
Oh, yes, thank you for my... Yes, I do. Testing, 1, 2. Testing. Are you coming up, please? Testing, okay. Yes. The first Wednesday we studied the will of God, we studied about finding the will of God. And there's a religious way to go about it. Religious way is, I'm still waiting on God, for Him to do, reveal His will to me. I still don't know. It's almost like putting the blame on God for not knowing the will of God. Okay, that's a religious concept. But they will quote scriptures from the Old Testament. But not all the Old Testament scriptures, they apply to you in the sense that we are God's children. We are son and daughter of God. Amen? And so, the will of God, being the will of God, God is very excited to reveal His will to you. I know that from my own life, that when I was 17, and God began speaking about doing the gospel work, I would ask Him to confirm His calling. And God would do it again, 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 and again, and again without fail. And I saw in that, in God repeatedly confirming, speaking His will to me, I saw His long-suffering aspect of it. Because when God spoke to me, I was 17, and by the time I stepped out, I was 22. So 5 years, I'm arguing, debating, fighting with God, quarreling. You know, not sure, you know, is this real? What? Because I couldn't see myself doing gospel work. I couldn't see myself. Not real, but God must make some mistake. But honestly, you know, 5 years. But finally, you know, I experienced long suffering of God in the sense that, but God made it so clear to me this is what He wanted me to do. And I had to choose what He already chose for me. So it wasn't a struggle to know the will of God, but it was a struggle for me to surrender my own will. It was a struggle to say, you know, let Buddha die. Let God be alive in my soul. And so so you don't fulfill God's will by accident. Right? You know God's will, and it doesn't just happen. You purpose for it, and you hear from God, and you simply do it. Right? And there are people that say, you know, God is all sovereign, so if it's God's will, I will do His will. No, that's not how it works. God is sovereign, but God also respects your will. God respects your will. He will ask, He will command, He will tell you, but it's up to you to obey Him or not. Right? So, and He is more motivated in revealing His will to you than you're motivated, because it's His will. It's His plan, His purpose, right? And God is not at all resistant, or God is not waiting to reveal His will to you, not at all. That's all religious concept, right? And also, you won't find all of God's will at once, right? When God was teaching, speaking about doing gospel work, God never told me that I would be a teacher, biblical teacher. God never told me that. All that God told me was quit my job and do the gospel work. I didn't know my gift. I didn't know I had a gift of whatever. I just didn't know anything. And that was progressively was revealed to me. You know what I should be doing in the gospel world. Right? There are people very evangelistic, and there are people that are very prophetic. And so my calling is not for that. I'm not trying to be an evangelistic person. So it'll come one step at a time. But very often you won't know the second step till you fulfill the first step. Right? So whatever the first step is, has been fulfilled. Right? So we covered all that. Then, the following Wednesday, we covered how God has a unique calling for each person. You each one of you are special. You have a purpose. You're not an average Christian. You're not like just like other people. You are special. You have a special calling, and there is something God wants you to do. And unique and specific, and between you and God. Amen? Right, so we covered that topic. And now, two essential needs or qualities, right, to do God's will. And those two are found in Acts chapter 6, verse 3. In Acts chapter 6, what we read there is, the church just got birthed on the day of Pentecost, and thousands were being added. Thousands were being added to the church. And the 12 apostles, because one died and another one got added or replaced, they were very busy preaching the gospel. And then believers were being added, so busy. Then some people were being neglected, right? So some complaint came to the apostles. Complaint came and said, the tables are not being served. Like, things are not being done properly. So they said, look, for that part of the will of God to be done, then look out among yourself. And the apostles gave two qualities to be met. Right? And so these qualities were meant for people to serve the tables, but in essence, it applies to every child of God and doing God's will. Right? It's not just for serve the table. And when the apostle said that, choose out among yourself people with these two qualities, that means the apostles themselves have these qualities. Because I cannot tell someone have this good quality in the spiritual sense if I don't have that. I'm not talking about academic and other skills, but in spiritual sense, right? So what are those two qualities? Acts chapter 6, verse 3. And this goes for every child of God who wants to do the will of God. And we already looked at the first aspect last Wednesday, and we want to look at the second aspect today, which is very important, which is these two are so important. And we saw how they said, Acts chapter 6, verse 3. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among yourselves, servant men of honest report. First of all, make sure they have honest report. They have proper life, holy lifestyle, right? They're not living in sin. They're not moving around, right? They have honest report, right? Full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom. The full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, they can go together, because when you're full of the Holy Ghost, wisdom and faith and love, everything, they follow, okay? So the two primary qualities are honest report and full of the Holy Ghost. Okay. And these two qualities apply to every child of God who wants to do God's will. Whether you're a teacher, whether you're an exhorter, a prophet, whatever. A driver, a giver, whatever. Right? And we covered the first part, that was the burden that Paul revealed to Timothy. Paul told Timothy, doing God's will, take heed to yourself. In other words, keep yourself pure. Because in doing God's will, whether you're up in the front, or in the back, on the side, or on the left, or right, whatever, if things in your life go wrong, in the sense that you're committing sin or whatever, doing some things, that itself can damage your conscience. Is that true? It'll make you weak. And if people find out, and you're accused, and if that's true in your life, in your conscience, in your soul, it can make you really weak. Like, you will lack the boldness to stand and minister, and you'll become fearful. And righteous and bold like a lion, right? And so, it's very important, and that does happen sadly. Again, I've not been ministering too long, but the short little 18 years, I've seen a lot. I've seen people that just eloquent speakers, oh boy, they can can fall like a ruler, just but they're caught with some sin. So silly sins. And rather than really repenting and putting it right, they will go about justifying it. You know? And then you can see them going to condemnation and attack and then just quit. Just for some. Right? And then it's sad. And no longer want to do gospel work. We don't want to come to that level. That's why Paul told Timothy, take heed to yourself, and said, add unto the doctrine the work you do. Continue in them. Even taking heed to yourself. Make sure that you're doing well yourself. In doing so, you shall save yourself and then the hearing. So that will give the first part of the qualification honest report. Right? You're not looking for a man's approval. No, no. You have God's approval. But you're keeping your life pure. Amen. Paul told Timothy, be an example to the believers. Be an example. That is having honest report. Don't you agree? Right? Because you can be a great teacher or preacher or prophet, whatever it is, or you're good at seeing visions and exhorting people, but if your life doesn't match it, people have a hard time accepting you. People can, they're free to judge. Right? They're free to. People, when they know that the messenger and the message, they don't really agree, they tend to stay away. That's the reality. That's the truth. Right? You cannot push people to accept you. They must be willing to accept your ministry. Amen? And so Paul told Timothy to be an example. In word, in how you speak. Wow. In word, how you speak, how you open your mouth, what do you say? Be careful in word. Right? In life or conversation, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity, right? Pretty much everything. Be an example. In other words, keep your honest report going. That is so important. Because not only people can accuse you, enemy can accuse you. Enemy can taunt your mind. Right? You want to come to a place by the grace of God, by the power of God, like Christ, is that the prince of the world cometh and finds nothing in you. That's an awesome testimony. The enemy comes, but he cannot point a finger at me. Right? Again, we're not saying that we do. Okay, let me explain about righteousness. Because there's sometimes a little confusion. Okay, righteousness is we are righteous through Christ. It's something we have. Is that true? That 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So we are made righteous because of Christ. It's done, deal, finished. Okay? Just because you're made righteous doesn't mean that you're acting righteous. It's another game altogether, another lifestyle. Right? One thing is that you are made righteous, another thing is being righteous. Right? Let's look at 1 John chapter 3, verse 7. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous. One is being righteous, you are righteous. Other one is doing righteousness. Is that true? Doing what is right. Doing what is right. And he that doeth righteousness is righteous. Right? Now, the religious people, they take that bottom part and say, that's how you attain righteousness. No, you don't attain righteousness. Righteousness is given to us by faith through Christ. We don't attain righteousness by works or by anything. It is by faith, like Paul said, it's given to us by faith in Christ. We are right, your spirit is made righteous because of Christ. But we want to practice that righteousness. Because sometimes people that have this understanding who they are in Christ, they throw away the practice part of it. The practice part means, oh, I can do whatever I want. You know, like one young man, I tried to correct him, and he said, I'm a spirit. But he was walking in the flesh. and he just wanted to listen to my counsel advice. And he thought that I was being too strict. And I said, I can back up the scripture, what you're doing is wrong. Please, scripture, back up. Well, no, I'm a spirit. I can do whatever I want. No. That's hard. Christ didn't live that way. Paul, apostle didn't live that way. And so that's foolishness. That's just arrogance, just pride. Right, so. Good. Now, that's not the main topic for today. So, the two qualities are honest report, that is, having, being righteous, and doing righteousness. Right? It's very essential. You have a life free of condemnation, free of guilt, free of accusation. And when you do right, people accuse you. It won't affect you at all. Right? You can still stand strong and be bold. Because you have done right. If you do wrong, repent. If you do right, right? If it needs to be asked for apology, I must apologize. Right? Now, the topic today is the next part. Full of the Holy Ghost. What does that mean? Full of the Holy Ghost. Right now, the baptism of the Holy Spirit itself is something new in this area. Right? Full of the Holy Ghost is the next level beyond that. Okay? It's still lacking in a lot of even spiritual Christians in this area. It's one of the reasons where I would say the will of God is not being really done. Right? What does it mean to be full of the Holy Ghost? What exactly does it mean? Because that's what they said. Men of honest report from the Holy Ghost. Now let's look at a few examples first and we'll see what this means. Let's start from Christ, right? Life of Christ. Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Luke 4, verse 1. He says, "And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost," is the best example. Right? Like I said, every deity must begin with Christ. Either his teaching or lifestyle. Amen? He's the best and perfect example. And then we see in the early church and explain the epistles and shadow found the Old Testament. Right, so, Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost. One key word I like to highlight there is the word being. Being means it's an ongoing experience. It's not just one time thing. Right? We are not being saved, you know, to go to heaven. No, we are saved once. Is that true? We receive salvation. And of course, we are being saved from attacking enemy and all that. But as far as eternal life is concerned, this is one time deal. It's done. You accept Christ and you are saved. You're not being saved that way. Right? But when it says being full of the Holy Ghost, it's an ongoing experience. It's not a one-time thing. Now, if you know by this time, Christ had already taken water baptism, and the Spirit of God, the form of a dove, had already come upon him. Is that true? It's water dove. And but Christ, we read, he was full of the Holy Ghost. What does it mean? What does it mean? Because a lot of Christians would be somewhat satisfied, yes, I have Holy Spirit in me and I do speak tongues here and there, but lack the revelation of full of the Holy Ghost. Full of the Holy Ghost. Because you would need that to help you do God's will. That power flows. See, you have power of the Holy Ghost. Is that true? You have Holy Spirit, you have power of the Holy Ghost. But that doesn't mean that power is actively working in your soul. It's active. Experience over here. Your spirit has power. You have power. Right? But one thing is to have power, the Holy Ghost, another thing for the power of the Holy Ghost to be active. It's working. Is that true? Like I said, it's one thing to be righteous and another thing to do righteousness. It's one thing to have power. And another thing to manifest that power, experience that power. Am I right? And that verse in Ephesians says, "Now unto him that is able to be exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that we have." No. According to the power that we have? No. According to the power working. According to the power that's actively working. Right? So, one of the reasons why we don't see more healing, more miracles, more casting out demons, more powers, is that The power of God is somewhat dormant in us. We have power. We don't lack anything. We don't lack anything. We have power. We have the Holy Ghost. We don't have junior Holy Spirit. The same Holy Spirit Christ had. Right? Right. We don't have junior Holy Spirit. We have the same Holy Spirit Christ had. Right? Because sometimes we get this strange thoughts in our mind, you know, I cannot do the works of Christ. No, those are lies. Those are lies. Right? Again, for those who never heard this, I was in Papua New Guinea and I had to go to this village to do a deliverance session, and the whole village came, maybe a few hundred, and they all pretty much in the witchcraft and nonsense, you know, demonic stuff. And I couldn't sit with one by one. There's no time, because my time was limited. I was there for just 2 or 3 days. And so then I took time to teach and I asked the Lord, Lord, how should we go about doing it? I just cannot sit one by one and do this, you know. I'll be worn out. And it's impossible time-wise, right? And the Lord put in my heart to do a mass deliverance. I have not done mass deliverance. And I looked at the example of Christ, you know. I'm just scanning Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in my mind. It's like a scanning the Bible. Christ never did mass deliverance, okay? And I'm scanning the book of Acts, you know, just chapters. I don't know all the chapters, but the basic what you know. And it wasn't done in the book of Acts. How am I supposed to do mass deliverance? It wasn't done by Christ. It wasn't done by apostles. Well, Christ said, you shall do greater works than I have done. And Lord, okay. You and I will do it together. And I found out, honestly, with all my heart, mass deliverance was much easier than one-on-one deliverance. It was much, much easier in the sense that I would just sit in the front and just call out the names. And people like, you know, just grasshoppers, boom, 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 and manifesting, screaming, shouting. And I wish I'd taken videos of those. And it was awesome. And who did it? The Holy Spirit. God did it. I was just a tool being used. But, you know, I'm no match to demons of Lucifer and Satan or nothing. I cannot match them. I'm a human being. I'm a mortal being. But God did all the work. God did it. And He gets all the glory. He gets all the praise. And I just sat down and just enjoyed the work of God. And it was awesome. So I wish you'd have been there to behold the whole thing. Just awesome. You have 200 people having deliverance at one time. It was an awesome experience. The power of the Holy Ghost. And people just rolling and shouting and screaming. Yet what I'm saying is that Christ never did mass deliverance. Right? You can type mass deliverance on YouTube. I think there's one or two YouTube videos. You can watch it. It's not the biggest. I think there's one video of real live mass deliverance on YouTube. You can type it, you can watch it yourself. But some done somewhere in Europe or America. Anyway. But see, I don't have junior Holy Spirit. Like I same Holy Spirit Christ had, and when Christ spoke, the Lord spoke and confirmed it, I just obeyed and did it. And so the power just flowed and do. So what I'm saying is that it's one thing to have power, I don't think to release the power. Experience of power, and so same with it's one thing to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit be in us, and He is in us, He is joined to us, He's one with us. Another thing to be full of the Holy Ghost, and the full of the Holy Ghost, it signifies the area of our soul. Right? It's not soul, because we do see our spirit has the power, our spirit has the strength, we don't lack anything. We are full, we are complete in Christ. But our spirit flows through our soul. Our spirit has to flow through our soul, and part of the soul is our mind, our heart. And that's where some of the blockage can happen. Oh, I cannot do it. What if I told the Lord, Lord, you never did it on the earth, and our person never did it. I'm not doing it. It's too difficult. That's it. What if I quench the work of God? But they say, Lord, okay. Because the Lord said, you shall do greater works. You know, you cannot do greater works than Christ if you have the Holy Spirit. It's not possible. You have the same Holy Spirit. It says, that's why God says, the same Holy Spirit. I think He says, same Holy Spirit. Let's read that. Who quickened Jesus Christ in Romans chapter 8. Uh, Not sure if I'm referring to another translation. Sorry? Romans 8 verse 11. I'm not sure if I'm the same spirit. If you have a translation that says it, you can read it out. But Romans 8 11 says, but the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. Right? But that is the same Holy Spirit. The spirit of him, the spirit of God that raised up Jesus Christ. So same Holy Spirit who raised up Christ dwells in you. Right? Same power, same Holy Spirit. It's nothing diminished. Nothing made low. Hallelujah. Amen. And now we want to be full of him in our soul, in our mind, in our heart. Be full of him. Right? I'll get to the practical part of it. But here's another example. Another example of a child of God being full of the Holy Ghost. Acts 7 verse 55. Acts 7 55. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost. So here's Stephen being stoned to death. Being put to death. At that moment of struggle, physical struggle, at that moment of being put to death, his spirit was about to depart from his body. He was yet still full of the Holy Ghost. Can you imagine? Picture yourself. You are being stoned to death and you're just perhaps dodging the stones. You know, these massive stones and sharp stones. It's not one or two, the crowd of them, you know, there's mob of them just stoning and perhaps you're dodging these stones and your skull perhaps cracked and you're bleeding and perhaps the flesh is hanging off. You're just being stoned and you're bleeding. Yet, seeing the vision of God, how awesome is that? That tells that a child of God who is full of the Holy Ghost, nothing can stop them. Nothing can hinder them. That's one of the reasons why in doing the will of God, it's so important to be full of the Holy Ghost. Because when you do the will of God, things will come, like discouragement, unbelief, you know, false accusation, people don't like you anymore, they speak bad about you, they gossip you, or things are not working well, so many things will come. Right? And if you're going to play a pity party, not full of the Holy Ghost. Right? You're going to feel sorry for yourself and quit. No, there's no quitting in God's kingdom. Hallelujah. So here is Stephen being stoned to death at the last moment, yet being full of the Holy Ghost. Being full of the Lord. Looked up steadfastly into heaven. His mind is all on God. And so the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Christ is always seated at the right hand of God. Christ doesn't stand. But at that moment, I'm sure Christ was respecting his brother Stephen. Christ was standing up. It's the only place, I believe, in the New Testament, when you come to the throne of God, Christ is standing up. He's always seated. Christ is seated on the right hand of God ever and interceding for us. But here, Christ is standing up. That is a welcome, as a respect. This Stephen is about to come, be with him in eternity, to heaven. But Stephen was full of the Holy Ghost. Is that awesome? And it's so needful because, like I said before, perhaps in my opinion, just my personal opinion, number one thing where people start doing the love of God and quit, I would say discouragement. I would say this. For some reason, get discouraged. Just, we say burnt out or quit, but just get discouraged. Things are not working well. They're not able to fight through it. Not able to go through it. Right? Let's look at another verse up here. Acts 11, 22-24. Another child of God. Barnabas. He says he was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost, preaching the gospel. Full of the Holy Ghost. So what exactly does it mean to be full of the Holy Ghost? I'll get to it. But it's something very meaningful, so important, that the apostle said, to serve the tables, make sure the guys are for the Holy Ghost. I mean, to serve the tables. Right? Perhaps, you know, put the pots on the table and I'm not sure what tables all meant, but to serve the tables, make sure they were full of the Holy Ghost. Right? That again, the mind of God applies to every person who wants to do God's will. That really effectively do and keep doing the will of God. Because God doesn't get glory when someone stops. God doesn't get glory in sickness. God doesn't get glory in discouragement. God doesn't get glory in depression. God doesn't get glory in someone quitting. God doesn't get glory in that. God gets glory when someone keeps doing. God gets glory when sickness is healed. God gets glory when demons are cast out. Hallelujah. So God gets glory when someone keeps going. Like the Eveready battery that commercial that used to play. You know, just keep going. Just keep going. Just keep going. Right? So here is Barnabas. So then tidings of these things came unto ears of the church, which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth Barnabas, that he should go as far as Antioch. Travel quite a bit. Who when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart, they would cleave unto the Lord. You know, make your heart is in love with the Lord. Your heart is in tune with the Lord. Your heart is cleaving to the Lord. It's beautiful. That means his heart was cleaving to the Lord.
Amen.
The word cleave is a powerful word. To cling, to cleave to the Lord. That is one purpose, make sure your heart is cleaving to the Lord. Just your heart is just joined in your heart. You know, first love with the Lord. I'm sure that means he was that way. Otherwise, he would have been a hypocrite preaching that to his people. He was that way.
It's like a child. Like,
what's that?
This is like a child when they cling to their parent.
Exactly, yes. Exactly. Absolutely. Like a baby clinging to the mother, yeah, absolutely. For he was a good man, verse 24, and full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Ghost, and of faith, and much people were added unto the Lord. Full of the Holy Ghost, right? Now, before I explain what full of the Holy Ghost is, one thing I'd like to explain, that Holy Spirit, in the Word of God, he's known in many ways, many aspects. One way is known as the Spirit of Life. Okay? Spirit of God is more of the Spirit of Life. And just look at a few examples, a few verses. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. Right? Just two or three verses to prove that he is known as the Spirit of Life. Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, that is God, not of the letter, not of the law, right? But of the Spirit. For the letter killeth. The law brings death. But the Spirit gives life. Right? Holy Spirit, he's a life giver. Right? He's a life giver. He's the Spirit of life. And the life of Christ that you have in you. Because Christ is life. Christ, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. Right? Amen? And that life is already in you. You don't lack that life. Life is in you. But Holy Spirit being the helper, he brings out that life. And to a point where you experience life for yourself first. You know, I was telling someone yesterday, the burden I have for the body of Christ, the primary burden I have for the body of Christ, is that each child of God would enjoy the Lord first. Just enjoy the Lord first. And out of enjoyment, out of life with the Lord, then ministry would flow. Right? To me, that's the best way. If you just do the ministry and not enjoy the Lord, we can get so dry. And it can get boring. And it can, you know, it can become like the law. I've got to do this without any passion, any enjoyment. And people can feel it. You know, you talk to someone and you want to encourage someone, but you yourself, you have now, but let me encourage that person. But you know, it doesn't come out the way if you are bubbly up yourself. You're just bubbling up inside and you're full of encouragement. And then out of that overflow comes, it's so real. You're not trying to make things up. Amen? So Holy Spirit is not the Spirit of life. And he wants us to enjoy life. First of all, and out of this, Romans 8 verse 2, for the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Let's say again, the spirit of life. Right? Spirit of life. Law means what he dictates. It's not the law of the Moses. It's law of the Holy Spirit. He would tell them, law of Moses told them what to do. Right? It's law of the Holy Spirit. And this is what I call personal laws. Spirit of God will give you personal laws. Personal laws that you should do that others cannot do. Right? I'm sure we all have personal laws given by the Holy Spirit. Right? Again, Spirit of God is born the Spirit of life. In other words, Revelation 11:11, right? There's two witnesses. They were literally dead. They were dead. That means the spirit left, right? Because death means the spirit's body is separate. And they were dead. They were in Jerusalem. The whole world was watching. Then the Spirit of God, from God, came, entered into them, and they got resurrected. Again, Spirit of God is born, Spirit of life. Right? Spirit of life resurrected them, raised them up, right? Made them alive. Right? So, Spirit of God is born, Spirit of life. And how do we become full of Him? Okay? I'll tell you practically what it means to me personally. The first time I received the Holy Spirit spoke in tongues was when I was a teenager. Right? A teenager, in my late teenage years. It was the first time I spoke in tongues. But I don't think I was full of the Holy Ghost. Right? I was speaking in tongues here and there. Then I went to the seminary. Now, I'm in my early 20s. And there was one pastor, one missionary, from how much of it was from England or so my country was from, anyway, from Europe. He was explaining about the Holy Ghost. And he was teaching about it, talking about it, you know, as part of the classes, teaching the Pentecostal seminary. And I would see him pray in tongues, but the way he was praying in tongues was not like how I would pray in tongues. Like, I would, till then, I would pray in tongues, but I would sit down and, you know, be on a in a religious way, and I would pray in tongues, and I would justify myself. I'm still speaking in tongues. But the way he would pray in tongues, it's like rivers flowing through, man. There's something different about that guy spoken in tongues. It's like he was full of the Holy Ghost, and I would just speak in tongues. It's like a rivers, mighty tongue rivers flowing through. Not so much a volume, but you get the sense, it's a clear flow. And the guy would have no fear and nothing, and just this authority and boldness. See, I had, in my early 20s, I had Holy Spirit and I was speaking in tongues. Oh boy, to witness to someone on the street, I was scared. You know? And we were in the neighborhood, we knew it, and there were some drug addicts and alcoholics, and I'd be careful who I would speak to. Now I was quite timid, to be honest with you. I would be timid. And even to stand up and in the front and speak to people, I was timid. Honestly. But after I learned to be full of the Holy Ghost, let the like Holy Spirit flow through me like a river, fears just left, as if I never had those fears in my life. The timidity and fears and certain control just left. Just completely left me. You know? So to me exactly, then what is it to be full of the Holy Ghost? To me is, praying in the Holy Spirit, personally, praying in the Holy Spirit, but it comes to a point where it's not just even praying, but just rivers just flowing through your tongues. And you can do it perhaps enjoyably, do it for perhaps half an hour, 1 hour, 2 hours. Just enjoy doing it, just rivers just flow through it. And then, to me, at that moment, I'm so much in the Spirit, hearing God's voice and being that is so easy. Hearing God's voice is no longer a struggle. It's no longer a struggle. Right? Now, I can remain in that moment and keep that going, and I can perhaps my mind can get distracted and loose after a while But it's good to, because my mind can get distracted. be full of the Holy Ghost. Now, do I still pray like that way? Yes, I do. I do. Right? This whole study I prepared after I prayed in tongues through for an hour or two. Right? And when I say I prayed in tongues, I'm not saying I sat down and read a much. No. Well, let me turn off the mic up here. I'll show you how I prayed today. I sat down on the couch, I turned the microphone, so it'll be too loud. I'm just it's different. It's not even volume. It may sound like volume, but it's just rivers just flowing through. It's unstoppable rivers. And it is different than just speaking tongues a little bit. You have to get it as a revelation for yourself, is what I'm saying. Right? You have to experience it for yourself to know what I'm talking about. Unless it's like, they both sound same to me. It's not same. I know what I'm talking about. Both are not same. One is, of course, the praying in tongues, interceding, and that's fine as well. Another thing is, it just, the river is just gushing out through you. It's flowing out through you. And that's the way I understand to be full of the Holy Ghost. And the more I do it, now if I would do it 8 hours a day, no, I don't do 8 hours a day, no, I don't. But I wish I could do it. That much, my soul will be saturated by the Holy Spirit. My mind, my heart will be just filled with the Holy Ghost. Because He's the one speaking. He's the one allowed to dominate my soul. See, my mind is shut down at the moment. See, Reuben's mind is shut down. Because when I pray in tongues, that's not Reuben's mind is shut down. What I'm saying is that, like Paul says, when he's praying in tongues, the mind is unfruitful. Is that right? Because the mind is shut down means I'm not thinking what to say next, is what I'm saying. Mind can still active in the sense you can think about different things. But to me, I'm listening very carefully as to what he is saying, what he is speaking, what is he revealing, what is he telling, right? What is his plan? And that's what my mind is on him, on the Holy Spirit. But to me, it's very easy to pray in that mode. And being the Spirit is very easy. And there are, not nowadays, but old-time preachers, like Lester Sumner Over and different preachers, they will get up Sunday morning and go for an hour walk, just flow in the Spirit. They'll take a walk, just flow in the Spirit, come back, and just write down what God spoke to them, and preach that Sunday. Right? That's being full of the Holy Ghost. Not being full of the Google. It's the same thing for messaging Google. But for the Holy Ghost, and you're delivering what the Spirit of God gave you to do. Right? So, why is so essential is that, one is that you are helped by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a helper. He is given to help us. And we want to get fullness of His help. And number two, when His power is working, no power can withstand your soul. That's why in 1 Peter we read, we are kept by the power of God. Right? And when your soul is full of the power of God, along the power comes wisdom and faith and joy and peace and just flowing in your soul, it's hard to be discouraged. It's impossible to be full of the Holy Ghost and be discouraged. Impossible. Just what I'm telling you. Impossible. Impossible is impossible. It's impossible to be full of the Holy Ghost and to be sad. Impossible. He being a helper, He will bring out the joy that is in you. The joy of the Lord, He will bring it out. He will just fill your heart and mind with joy. Impossible to be depressed before the Holy Ghost. Impossible. Look at Stephen the martyr. That guy was being stoned to death. Yet, so still spiritually minded. Seeing the Lord standing up. I mean, put yourself in the situation. That's hard, physical. Skull cracking. You know, the stones making holes in your body and tearing your flesh, and yet still be full of the Holy Ghost. Right? And now, I'm not saying that we're going to be constantly speaking in tongues to be full of the Holy Ghost, but when that is how it's initiated, started, and if you're careful, you can remain in that more. Do you get what I'm saying? You don't need to be screaming in tongues and praying in tongues to be full of the Holy Ghost. But being human beings, we have life on this earth, we can get distracted. Earthly worries, earthly burden comes, and then we can lose track of the Holy Spirit in our mind. We shouldn't, but we can. It does happen. Is that true?
Yeah.
It does happen. We are human beings. It's good bet. And that's why Paul, knowing this truth, he would pray in tongues a lot. See? There is something lacking today in the body of Christ. That's so lacking. Right? Speaking in tongues itself is despised. And perhaps speaking in tongues a lot is even more despised. Right? Paul, he didn't know. He knew the reason why he did. He was dependent on the Holy Ghost. He was dependent on the Holy Ghost. That's why he wrote the things he wrote, you know, in Corinthians more earlier. He wrote, I'm not merely able minister by myself. I'm able minister by the Spirit of God, for He gives life to able ministers. Amen? And then some ministers, even the spiritual ministers, if they don't keep themselves dependent on the Holy Spirit, they can get burnt out, they can get discouraged. And they're not appear discouraged. They can get up Sunday morning and give an awesome message. And people get a clap, but in their personal lives, they're discouraged. That could happen. I see people mask their struggles. They can mask, put on a smile and do well, but personal life, oh boy, they're struggling big time. I met pastors, ministers, they're struggling in pornography. It's porn, addicted to porn. And full of condemnation, yet they can minister, it's good to keep ministering, but in the pit of discouragement after that, that's not how God meant the life to be. To me, God meant life to enjoy every day 24/7. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Not have some other hidden struggle and be somebody else publicly. No. Right? So that's what to me. So when that was explained in seminary, I realized I need to have a reverse flowing through me. What Christ spoke, you know, reverse of living water. Just to flow through me. Reverse of living water through me. I realized I needed to have the experience daily. And so there in seminary in the morning we would have time of prayer before we have classes that we taught. And most often I would just, now the phrase they use, okay, here's the phrase they use in the charismatic world, and how much of you, you don't have to agree with this phrase or not, but they use the phrase breakthrough. Anyone heard that phrase? Breakthrough, right? Is where you pray in tongues, but you come to a point where it is broken through the spirit, so to speak, and your mind is very heavenly. Your mind is just very heavenly, seeing visions and hearing from God, it is just natural. Does it make sense? It's just natural. And at that moment, you've broken through the earthly barrier. Because mind can be earthly mind. And once again, we have to have earthly minds, and we have to do our garden work, get a book, and you know, those are heavenly stuff. Those are earthly stuff. We have to get them done. We are still human beings. We still have flesh to feed. We have a body to feed, right? And people look after it. We have to work with the missionary that works. Those are heavenly stuff. You know, those are earthly stuff. But it's good. Holy Spirit helps our mind to be heavenly minded. Because He is a helper, and He's the best helper. And He helps us to the point that we allow Him to help us. Right? How much you want His help, that's how much He will help you. Like, to me, again, personally, is just depending on Him, and that's by praying in tongues. And sometimes you'll see, I don't know if you've heard already, sometimes you'll hear me just 2 minutes praying in tongues, and I'll go on to different tongues. And it sounds like I'm warring, fighting. Right? With some fighting. If that happens, usually I'm doing warfare in the spirit realm. And I can sense, and it's fun in the spirit, because heavenly mind is not a natural mind. Earthly mind is a natural mind. Heavenly mind is a spiritual mind. And Holy Spirit being heavenly, He's of heaven, He's God. He wants to help us to have heavenly mind. And that will help us to do ministry and help others to, and will keep your mind pure, keep your mind good. Right? No wonder Paul, I mean, apostles told, even the ones who serve the table, actually they're full of the Holy Ghost. And maybe those guys, you don't want them to lust after the wrong people or what it is. makes people full of the Holy Ghost. Keep your mind on the Lord and they do their jobs. You know, you keep your job on the Lord and you do what you want, what the Lord wants you to do. And He's a great helper. Great helper. Does it make sense now to us? Anyone disagrees or understand? Well, if you disagree, I can't help you much, but that's pretty much what I understood over the years before the Holy Ghost. And then again, I wouldn't say I go on a daily basis, but almost daily basis, almost. Then I'll sit down and at least a few minutes just break through the Spirit. Just break through the Spirit, well, and then just flow in the Spirit and get thoughts, understanding, ideas, whatever it is, and to help me and help others, whatever it is. And it's awesome to keep that way, and I'm telling you what I depend on, right? And there are times, like today, for example, I didn't go to the mechanic to get something done. The mirror tires to be swapped, the regular tires, wheels. And I just pulled out, and suddenly just thundered in the Spirit, just in tongues. I was by myself, just for about 4 or 5 minutes, just thundered in. That's awesome. To me, I just enjoyed it. It feels such a, like a refreshment, just a joy just overflowing through your mind, right? And that's Holy Spirit. That's not Reuben. That's Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Such old-time preachers are gone. Majority of them are gone. You know, majority of such old-time. Because some people say, oh, that is Pentecostal. No, that's not Pentecostal. That is Holy Spirit. You know, that's not Pentecostal. You know? That's Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. That's telling I depend on the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit speak through me, work through me, and depend on you, and pray through me. Do whatever you want to do through me. Hallelujah. Include the will of God, and He enables, He strengthens, and He enforces your mind. And whatever the Lord is speaking to you to do, He makes it strong. He's a spirit of power. He makes it strong, and you're able to carry out what God wants you to do. Hallelujah. Now, this verse up here, John 7, 38 and 39 says, for out of the belly shall flow rivers of living water, not one river, but rivers of living water. I did a thought on it one time, I just was meditating. And the Lord took me to this four rivers out of the Garden of Eden, interestingly. Right? Four rivers, that is a while back, the Garden of Eden. Then I got interested in these four names of the rivers, interestingly. Genesis chapter 2, 10 to 14. These four rivers came out of the Eden and watered the garden. Very interesting. Right? And the names were given too. Right? So I was meditating and I said, let me look at the meanings of these names. And I found them very interesting, actually. And it just was eye-opening. I'm not sure if you heard me already share about this, but this garden being watered, perhaps spiritually, can signify your ministry. Eden can signify where you live in heaven. I'm sure Eden, before the fall, was heaven on earth. Don't you think so? Eden was on earth. Right? It was heaven on earth. There was no violence, there was no problem, there was no disobedience, nothing, just heaven on earth. It was beautiful, it was innocence. And we are heavenly saints, aren't we? We are heavenly saints, right? And being heavenly minded, we want to do the will of God. So this one river, I think if you read carefully, one river became four rivers, right? And a river, that's where it begins, right? How much do we read it? And a river, Genesis 2, went out of Eden toward the garden. And from thence it was parted and became four heads. Right? So one river is one Holy Spirit. But it functions in many ways. Right? So when Christ said, reverse the living water, one river could be joy, one river could be power, one river could be strength, one river could be this, one river could be wisdom, one river, you name it, there He is, Holy Spirit. Right? Reverse the Holy Spirit. So these four names are very interesting. Those four names are in verse 11, Genesis chapter 2, verse 11, Pison. I'll just quickly share what I found through researching that stuff. And Gihon, and Hiddekel, and Euphrates. The four names, the Hebrew names. Right? And very interestingly, all four rivers have beautiful spiritual meanings. And very interestingly also, these meanings, they correspond to the work of the Holy Spirit. Very interesting. Why? Because when Christ said that rivers of living water will flow out of you, then Christ said, then he says, this he spake about the Holy Spirit. It's very clear. Right? The rivers of living water was in reference to the Holy Spirit working through us. So, Holy Spirit is not meant to be dormant in us. Rivers of living water flowing out means it's an active lifestyle. It's alive, it's active, it's experiencing. That's why Christ said, this is meant by the Holy Spirit that the other believers should receive. Meaning, it's an active experience. Right? And that would mean, if you keep in the lifestyle, it means the full of the Holy Ghost. Meaning, full of the Holy Ghost means you're fully dependent on Him. You're not half Karen and half Holy Spirit. You're full of the Holy Ghost means there's no Karen there. Does it make sense? That means Holy Spirit is putting thoughts in your mind and they're no longer Karen's mind, but Holy Spirit's mind. It's full of the Holy Ghost. When it's full of the Holy Ghost, Rose is not there. It's Holy Spirit directing you, leading you. And His mind becomes your mind. And that means you're fully dependent on Him and He's fully working through you. As long as you stay dependent on Him, He's working through you. And Christ also, because Christ was a perfect God, was a perfect human being. Being a perfect human being, He depended on the Holy Spirit. He was depending on the Holy Spirit. He was depending on the Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit worked through Him and He functioned out of the help of the Holy Spirit and did a glorious ministry on this earth. Hallelujah. And we too can be that way too, the more we depend on the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. We will see more healing, more deliverance, more action, more joy, more exhortation, more prophecies, and everything just increase. Hallelujah. His Holy Spirit increases. Hallelujah. But if Reuben is 90% Reuben and 10% Holy Spirit in mind, then that's how much He can work through me. Right? And we want to be full of the Holy Ghost. Reuben 2. Hallelujah. Right, so quickly, let's go through names quickly. Right, and look at the scriptures. Pison means to increase. In Hebrew, you can check the Hebrew Bible and Hebrew dictionary and meaning. If you doubt me, if you're not sure, I've done my homework. Pison means to increase. Okay, increase. And the river Pison was flowing in the land of Havilah, a place of gold. Again, if you read in Genesis 2, it says it. But it was flowing in the place of gold. And in the New Testament, gold signifies faith. Right? First Peter says the trial of faith is compared to gold. Right? So, Holy Spirit, He wants to increase. Your spirit is full of faith. Right? You have faith. You don't lack faith. Right? We don't have little faith and no faith and all the nonsense. We have faith. We have faith in God. But you want that faith to be released in our soul and increased in our soul. Is that true? Faith to be just increased in our soul and magnified and faith to be more real. Well, who does? Who helps? Holy Spirit. Let's look at this verse, Jude verse 20. Right? Holy Spirit is very active in wanting to help us to increase the faith in our soul. Jude verse 20. But ye, beloved, building up means to increase. Like the river Pison. Increase yourself on your most holy faith. How? Pray the Holy Ghost. Being full of the Holy Ghost. Right? Just pray the Holy Ghost. It's so clear. So simple. We don't need to say, God, I want more faith, no faith. No, no. You have faith. It needs to be boosted in your soul, built up in your soul. You don't need to waste time praying, give me faith. No, faith doesn't drop from heaven. You have faith in you. You know, it doesn't drop from heaven. You have faith in you. Right? We are blessed with